Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Michele Esposito. I'm the executive director of the Institute for Palestine Studies here in Washington. And I thank you all very much for being with us today for our panel discussion on the legal assault on Palestinian rights activism. Our panel today will be chaired by the Institute's Journal of Palestine Studies editor, Dr. Rashid Khalidi, who is the Edward Said Professor of Modern Arab Studies at Columbia University. He's also former president of the Middle East Studies Association and was advisor to the Palestinian delegation at Madrid and Washington Arab-Israeli peace negotiations from October 1991 until June 1993, which is before Oslo. He's also the author of numerous books on Palestine, most recently Brokers of Deceit, How the U.S. Has Undermined Peace in the Middle East, which is the recent winner of the 2014 Lionel Trilling Book Award. I'm going to turn the panel now over to Dr. Khalidi, who will introduce our panelists. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you all for coming. Let me ask a rhetorical question, which of course I'm going to answer. Why are we here for a panel on the topic legal assault on Palestinian rights activism? There are actually two main reasons. The first is that over the past, maybe decade and a half, Palestinian rights activism in the United States has taken on a remarkable vitality. It is now functioning to an extent I do not recall in the many decades I've experienced these things in this country, on college campuses. It's functioning in churches, in many synagogues, among Muslim communities and mosques. It's beginning to work among unions. It's beginning to function in the general public as well, with a great deal of effectiveness. Obviously, this isn't the first time that there has been activism around Palestine in American public life, but with a plethora of disparate and, in many cases, growing organizations. They're not just organizations, they're organizations that are expanding quite rapidly. This activism now has a range and has an extent, and I think has an impact in this country that it never did before. You need only look at the full page ad in the New York Times 2 days ago by a group opposing the Presbyterian Church's recent movement to divest from companies involved with the Israeli occupation to see that it's having an impact. Somebody spending the money for a full page ad obviously has a problem. And you know, as I do, I'm sure, some of the reasons and some of the groups that are engaged in this activism, people working on boycott, divestment, and sanctions, people in the U.S. campaign and the Israeli occupation, Students for Justice in Palestine, Jewish Voice for Peace, many, many other active groups are having an impact. So that's the first reason. There is a significant uptick in Palestinian rights activism in this country. The second reason that we're here today and discussing this topic is that those who oppose justice for Palestinians, those who oppose Palestinians having the same rights as other people, self-determination, access to land, right to not have their homes blown up without trial or hearing or anything, people who oppose the Palestinians having the same rights as other people, in fact, have a very difficult time in this country when the story gets out. It's the sort of advocacy that dare not speak its name. You can't really say, I'm against Palestinians having equal rights. I'm in favor of a system whereby systematically people are denied rights. You can't say that. Or if you do, you're not going to get a very good hearing in this country. Who wants to self-identify as an advocate of oppression, say, or 47 years of military occupation, or of colonization of other people's land, or of unequal rights? So instead of meeting advocates for Palestinian rights in the open, and instead of saying forthrightly that Palestinians just shouldn't have equal rights, or that Palestinians don't exist, these advocates, as say opponents of rights for Palestinians, resort to subterfuge, resort to dissembling, resort to disinformation, and when they're desperate, they resort to outright vilification, using the term of art, in this case, of course, for blanket condemnation of any effective Palestinian rights activism, unfortunately, is often anti-Semitism, which of course cheapens something that is a very serious issue, the issue of real anti-Semitism, of real Jew hatred, by applying it to anyone who's simply advocating for equal rights for Palestinians. In the arsenal of these advocates of unequal and inferior rights for Palestinians, if these people recognize that Palestinians exist at all, legal and semi-legal means take pride of place. This is the second reason that the Institute for Palestine Studies is sponsoring this panel. We feel that this issue has now reached the level where more attention should be focused on it, both to expose the underhanded means that are often used to silence those who are advocating for equal rights for Palestinians, but also to give people who are engaged in efforts to secure these rights an understanding of how they might go about improving their performance, how they might learn from others, and how they might help increase general knowledge in this area. We have to admit that in the United States, there's not as much general knowledge as there should be around this issue. If you go anywhere else in the world, people are considerably more knowledgeable than they are in the United States. I ascribe that in some measure to the American media, especially the mainstream corporate media, who instead of performing the task of illuminating and informing people, performs a task that can best be described by an Arabic word from the root jahl, which means ignorance. The media, in fact, perform the task of tashhir. They make people more ignorant. In fact, there are polls that show that people who watch mainstream media news know less about the world, are dumber, in effect, than people who don't. Fortunately, most young people are smarter than that. They don't resort to the mainstream corporate media, or if they do, they do it selectively and with an intelligent understanding of what to look at and what not to look at. So increasing general knowledge is an important aspect. Angela Davis just said 2 days ago in New York at a panel that I was not able to attend because I was on another panel, which is an indication of what's beginning to happen in this country. I mean, so there's a lot of stuff happening, and that's a really, really good thing. She said that the Palestine issue is the Vietnam of our time, it's the South Africa of our time. It's the moral issue of our time. And it's a litmus test of a real commitment to justice in the 21st century. It is obviously a hard issue, but it is one that, if clearly explained, is in fact very straightforward. The Institute has brought together today a panel including some of the most experienced and active participants in the defense of Palestinian rights, people who are activists against this legal assault, as well as Stephen Zaita, who might be described as someone who has experienced such an assault. I'll very briefly introduce them. I think you've all seen their bios, but starting immediately to my left is Andrew Dalek, who works for the National Lawyers Guild. He was involved in the defense committee for Rasmea Odeh, who was just convicted on one count in Chicago, and he's been working on that case. He serves as co-chair for the National Lawyers Guild's Palestine subcommittee, and he works all over the country. His current real job, I mean, all this is what he does, you know, in his spare time. His real job is in the public defender's office in New York City. Next to him is Dima Khalidi, who is the founder and director of Palestine Solidarity Legal Support and a cooperating counsel with the Center for Constitutional Rights, which is also an organization that's active, like the National Lawyers Guild, in these efforts. Palestine Solidarity Legal Support provides legal advocacy to protect and advance the rights of people who are activists around Palestinian human rights issues all over this country. Next to her, again, moving leftwards, just in terms of direction on the panel I'm talking about, is Yanan Salahi, who is a staff attorney with the National Security and Civil Rights Program at Advancing Justice-Asian Law Caucus in San Francisco. His work focuses on challenging policies that developed after 9/11 to undermine the civil rights and liberties, especially of Middle Eastern, Muslim, and South Asian communities. He works on issues of freedom of speech, especially as regards student activism, where there are some really very disturbing trends going on, and I'm sure several of the panelists will speak about that. Finally, there's Stephen Zaita, who is an academic, former associate professor of English at Virginia Tech, who was hired and then unhired in an outrageous maneuver from a tenured position at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign for his quote-unquote uncivil tweets about Israel's attack on Gaza in the summer of this year. There's been a huge public outcry about it. He's just been on a speaking tour where I saw him in New York. to expose the way in which intimidation is used to silence critics of some of Israel's policy. So the four panelists will speak one after another in the order I've given you. And once again, let me thank you all for coming.